الله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله لا نفرق بين أحد من رسله وقالوا سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها لها ما كسبت عليها ما اكتسبت ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا وأخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين صدق الله العظيم
اهلا بكم جميعا السادة الاساتذه والزملاء الافاضل انا مبسوط جدا لان رجعت المخرج يستلزم من الشعب نوعا ما حديثه عندنا وهي بتواكب هذا التخصص الجديد اللي هنشهد فيه تطورات كبيره جدا البوادر بتاعتها ابتدت تبان على اكسبيرمنتال ليفل واتمنى ان ايرا ان مصر تنهض في مجال البحث في الستم سيلز لان الفاسيلتيز بتاعت هذا البحث والخبرات موجوده وانا قاعد بين قطبين الاخطار اللي بتشتغل في هذا المجال انا متاكد هيبقى في اضافه شغلانه في السنين اللي جايه في هذا التخصص وشكرا
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ارحب بكم في المؤتمر بتاع الخاص بالحاله الجزائيه في جنة ميديسن وطبعا بشكر الدكتور محمد صبح على البرنامج القائم دوت very scientific approach, well organized, your topics are very well chosen. هو برانش جديد والمجالات بتاعته في مصر ابتدت very well applied خصوصا في الاكسبيرمنتال فيلد وجامعة المنصورة كان ليها نشاط كبير في الريسيرش في الستم سيلز ويمكن برضو الكلينيكال ابلكيشنز ليها فرصة كبيرة قوي ان احنا نسيت فيها يمكن في مصر كان لينا سبتك العالم كله في الانشيتنج الكلينيكال ترايلز اللي هنشوف في السيشن اللي جاي بعد دي ويا ريت ما نفقدش هذا السبت لان احنا عندنا تشانس يمكن اكتر من دول كتيرة ان احنا نابلاي كلينيكالي البنفيتس اوف ستيم سيلز وان شاء الله نشوف في السنين القادمه في ديفرنت برانشز الكلينيكال والريسيرش ابروش ان شاء الله وميتنج موفق ان شاء الله. اتفضل.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم طبعا بدايه اشكر زملاء الملاك في الجمعيه المصريه بهذا الارتباط في هذا المؤتمر في ارتباط بين شعبة الخلايا الجزيعية في الجمعية المصرية لأمراض زراعة الكلى مع بالتعاون مع مركز البحوث الطبية التجريبية في كلية طب المنصورة إن احنا شايفين أعتقد إن في المستقبل مبشر جدا إن الخلايا الجزيعية واستخداماتها في أمراض الكلى لها مستقبل قوي في جزء في مجال الاكسبرمنتيشن وبرضه في كلينيكال ترايلز في اليومن للتقام. في النهارده اليوم الثالث من المؤتمر بتاعنا بتاع مركز البحوث الطبيه التجريبيه كان في يومين الثلاث والاربع يوم كان بيزك اسبكتس اوف ستيم سيل ونانو تكنولوجي. نحن في مركز البحوث بنعتقد ان في حاجتين هيغيروا الطب تماما في العقد القادم هم النانو تكنولوجي والستمسل. يمكن النانو تكنولوجي خد خطوات جامده جدا. فاحنا عندنا في المركز مقتنعين وابتدينا فعلا في بعض المشاريع بنمرج بين النانو تكنولوجي مع الخلايا الجذعيه. في احد المشاريع لينا بالتعاون مع احد المراكز في امريكا المقدم يعني لسه اندر ايفالويشن بنستخدم النانو مع الستمسل. اليومين اللي فاتوا كنا بنتكلم في البيزك ساينس وكان مشارك معنا اساتذه من الطب ومن العلوم من قسم الكيمياء والصيدله والبيطري. بعد كده اليومين التانيين هم النهارده وبكره احنا هنا في القاعه دي كيدني وستمسل، انما في قاعه تانيه في الافرع الاخرى. ففي زمايلنا بتوع اوسلمانجي بيشتغل ستمسل واوسلمانجي، في الاوبي جايني شغالين دلوقتي، وفي النيورولوجي والديرماتولوجي، كل دول في سيشن موازنين. اعتقد ستمسل كموداليتي تريتمنت لها مستقبل كبير، وده واضح من اهتمامنا احنا ككبار، لا واضح اكتر في الشباب. عندنا في الميرك عندنا فرصه للطلبه سواء الاندر او البوست جرادويت، وفي اقبال هائل في هذا الاتجاه وأورينتد جدا. انا سعيد جدا امبارح في السيشن بتاعت النانو تكنولوجي كان على مستوى عالي جدا، والطلبه قايمين بيسالوا اسئله فيري هاي في مجال النانو تكنولوجي. احنا هنا يمكن النهارده احد الحاجات اللي بقدمها بحث كان قبل في الجامعه الاوروبيه اللي فاتت، وده كان طالب طلبه من سنه رابعه او خمسه. فاعتقد ستمسل بالذات مع نانو تكنولوجيا مستقبل واعد جدا جدا، وربنا يوفقنا جميعا ان شاء الله ان نعمل شيء للشباب ولبلدنا باذن الله. وشكرا.
والان هنرجع على طول السيشن الاولاني. تشير بيرسونز يتفضل. تشرف اقدم فيرست سبيكر استاذ الدكتور حسين شعيشه مجامعه المنصوره، فيري انرجيتك فريند اوف ماين، اضاف كتير ويب بيج مشهوره من سنين. اشكرك مره ثانيه يا حسين. اتكلمنا عن الاي كي اي از ان اوفر فيو. اتفضل.
شكرا جدا على التقديم اللي انت عملته في السلاش. برحب بكم جميعا في اول جلسه في المؤتمر ريليتد تكنولوجي. Today I'm speaking clinical because I'm speaking about overview on acute kidney injury. So I'll be focusing on definition, classification, risk factors and cause of acute kidney injury, clinical presentations and diagnosis, and I'll end with the management of acute kidney injury. Firstly, definition, the simple definition of acute kidney injury is a rapid deterioration of sort of the
Simply, acute kidney injury is defined as rapid deterioration of renal functions, resulting in the accumulation of nitrogenous waste such as urinary creatinine. It's a very simple definition. By rapid deterioration, I stress upon if we know the basal creatinine, this would be very important in the definition. It's one of the important criteria in diagnosis, as I mentioned later. With the evolution of definitions and classification, RIFL was on the stage in 2004. As you see, it includes three stages: risk, injury, and failure, RIF, and the two outcomes, variable loss and end-stage kidney disease. The definition is based on very simple criteria, serum creatinine or creatinine clearance. I think the formula to be used to estimate GFR is not accurate with acute kidney injury, because in acute kidney injury there is dynamic change in creatinine. So it is simple. If you have patient with the basal creatinine 1 mg/dL, and it increases to 1.5, this risk stage. So you can follow creatinine or creatinine clearance, or you follow the urine output criteria. So if the patient has urine output below 1.5 mg/hour for 6 hours, this is a stage of risk. And as you see, these are the different stages. If there is complete loss of kidney function for more than 4 weeks, this is a stage of loss, or one of the outcome variables. And the cutoff point and the cut edge between acute kidney injury and end-stage kidney disease is 3 months. So if there is complete loss of kidney function for more than 3 months, you can deal with the patient as in the stage
and you can prepare him for transplantation or on regular hemodialysis.
With the evolution of definition and classification, Aiken criteria, acute kidney injury network criteria, was evolved, and the difference between rifle and the Aiken between the first row, and risk increase, the increased sensitivity of rifle by, as you see, if cracking increased by equal or more than 0.3 milligram per deciliter, and not necessarily 50% fold increase of creatinine in this stage of risk. So it broadened the criteria, and it increased the sensitivity to capture all cases of acute kidney injury. And it just risk injury and failure, and no loss or any stage at survival. I want to stress that one occurrence of acute kidney injury in ICU is not good news, bad news, because it reflects on the patient's survival. So if the patient has acute kidney injury, as you see here, the survival, if no acute kidney injury, survival for patients on ICU for critical diagnoses is 50% within 3 years. But if there is acute kidney injury, especially if it is advanced stage, like stage 3, you can find the mortality less than 10%. One of the most important criteria that we usually omit is the urine output. If the patient is admitted to ICU, we should measure urine output carefully every day and every hour even, because as you see here, if you put these two figures together, you can find the repercussion of oliguria is more prominent on the patient outcome. So if here the 3 year, the survival 10%, here approximately no survival if the patient is completely oliguric. So we should take care of urine output and we'll take care of serum creatinine. Taken together, the European renal best practice guideline looked at Kidigo and unified the staging. So the current stage is based on this paper that was published online last month on acute kidney injury staging. It's just three stages. Stage one, if the patient has one of the following, serum creatinine increased to 1.5 to 1.9, or creatinine increasing more than 0.3, or urine output in this range of below 0.5 milli per kg per hour for 6 hours. So it just, they tried here in the unified staging to combine rifle and the Aiken criteria. Stage two is either one of the following, serum creatinine between 2 to 0.9, or fold, or if the patient has creatinine 1 and increased to 0.5, this is in stage 2, or urine output in this range. Stage 3, one of the following, creatinine exceeding 3 times baseline, or creatinine just above 4 milligram per deciliter, or the patient situation is stated initiation of renal replacement therapy, or urine output below 0.3 milligram per kg per hour for 24 hours or urine for 12 hours. So any criteria of these hold the patient in stage 3 acute kidney injury. One of the most important aspects in the management of acute kidney injury is to know the risk factors. And simply, a risk means that situation that put the patient in a prone position for acute kidney injury and not necessarily the occurrence of acute kidney injury. So simply, risk factors are either patient-related factors or doctor-related factors. So the patient-related factor, one of the most important patient-related factors is the pre-existing renal dysfunction. So the patient has baseline coronary kidney disease, this is a very risky patient for the occurrence of acute kidney injury on top of CKD. So we should take care of that. Another important risk factor is sepsis. The majority of patients with acute kidney injury have sepsis, and the majority of sepsis have acute kidney injury. All the age, diabetes, and you can find all these are risk factors from the patient's side. From the doctor's side, there are medications and there are procedures. We all, as nephrologists, hate non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, and we limit their use. Even the use of paracetamol is risky, and there is some recommendation. If I am obliged to use it, just one tablet per day, and if I am obliged to use non-steroidal, maybe one tablet for a week, based on the nephropharmacology that was published early last year. So we also don't like the aminoglycosidase antibiotic, as I mentioned later. Even the use of friendly drugs like ACE inhibitor, which are known as nephroprotective, we should take care of while we are using. So we should have serum creatinine before prescribing ACE inhibitors. And if there is any rise of creatinine beyond 1 week, we should follow repeating serum creatinine weekly until we are sure that they plateau within 20 to 30% of the baseline creatinine. And these are the procedures from the right side. Again, the KDIGO stressed on that issues. KDIGO recommended that patients be certified for risk of acute kidney injury. So it is very important risk factor because it's a window for preventive medicine to manage the patient according to their susceptibilities and exposure to reduce the risk. Even if this recommendation is not created, but it's very important for my mind, to assist the patients and increase the risk for acute kidney injury with measuring creatinine and urine output. Causes of acute kidney injury are known as pre-renal, renal, and post-renal. It's very simple. Pre-renal means the defect in the kidney perfusion, either hypovolemia or third space losses, and this is known for all of us. And post-renal means obstruction, increasing capsular pressure that reflects and antagonizes hydrostatic pressure. And renal, we can classify simply to the constituent of the kidney, so we can find causes related to glomerulonephritis, tubules and interstitial tubular interstitial nephritis, and blood vessel vasculitis. So this is the simple classification that is working with all of us. Again, the cause of acute kidney injury should be determined whenever possible, because if we know the cause, we can treat the patient properly. The clinical presentation of acute kidney injury ranges from just the history. We should search for the cause, as I mentioned, so proper history examination are very important. The patient may be oligoric and oligoric, and I just demonstrated that oligoric patients care for outcome, and this is not, please don't translate it to the that we should use diuretics, because there is a controversy in this issue. So if the patient is oligoric, this is bad predictor, but use diuretic, no, we shouldn't use diuretic, as I mentioned, in the treatment sector. Edema and hypertension, remix symptoms, and cessation of complication. One of the most important issues in managing acute kidney injury is to know serum potassium, because if it is missed and the patient is in hyperkalemia, especially if it's associated with EC changes, this may be put the patient, not only the patient, but also the doctor, in a critical situation, increasing medical aspects. So always, when we, even when I went to Saudi Arabia, I hate serum creatinine and hate serum potassium, because most of them put the patient on our side. So when we are taking history, and we should take care of a combination of symptoms, because it may refer to certain etiology. Fever, arthritis, rashes may refer to small cell vasculitis. Amongst plus acute kidney injury, we think of NGPM, small vessel vasculitis, etc. Presence of hemolysis, thrombocytopenia may refer to hemolytic uremic syndrome. Hypercalcemia, especially in elderly patients, we can diagnose multiple myeloma, so we should put it in our mind. It is not uncommonly present. And the recent intervention with the use of the dye, but here I want to stress upon the latent period. If you use maneuver depending on dye, and acute kidney injury occur with a time frame from 1 day to 2 days, this is contrasting with acute kidney injury. And if it takes a week or so, it is another syndrome, which is acero-embolic renal disease, the or cholesterol-like syndrome. If you find increasing CPK creatine kinase plus increasing creatinine, this is rhabdomyolysis. But as you know, the screen for the rhabdomyolysis is to examine urine by dipstick. If you find the blood by dipstick and know itself by microscopy, this is a screening of rhabdomyolysis. And I just remember the case that was published 2 months ago about the use of ciprofloxacin, which is antibiotic, and it may cause rhabdomyolysis. So it's not necessarily to have to roam to diagnose rhabdomyolysis. So the index of suspicion is important and just simple. No, blood by dipstick and no return by microscopy, always put it in our mind. It just measures CBK for the diagnosis straight away. So the ultrasound is very important. I don't consider ultrasound an examination, an investigation. It is just, it's examination of the kidney, because normally, in the normal consequences, we don't feel kidneys. We do feel kidneys only in the presence of obstruction or infiltration. And this is a normal ultrasound, and here I want to stress on the adequacy of ultrasound report. So ultrasound examination should tell us about the size of the kidney and the measure of the kidney, echogenicity, corticomedullary differentiation, and the presence or absence of fibronephrosis. If you look here, you'll find these strands of the white area. The white color here is the fat in the pelvis, and it takes white color in ultrasound. To compare with this moderate hydronephrosis, you can find the pelvis and the calcium system are dilated, and the urine take the black color. So this is this is obstructive kidney, and this is normal kidney. So the ultrasound discriminate if there is hydronephrosis, I diagnose obstruction and I should interfere immediately. If I interfere immediately, I save the kidney. If there is no obstruction, no hydronephrosis, no ultrasound, I hold the differential diagnosis later on. So regarding urine analysis is considered the most important initial investigation in acute kidney injury because it figures out the causes of acute kidney injury. And it is known as the liquid biopsy of the kidney, and it's a window of the kidney. So if we have a patient with acute kidney injury and with normal analysis, renal acute renal failure, you put in mind, if there is a red cell cast, red cell cast equal to nephritis. White cell cast means tubular interstitial nephritis or pyelonephritis. Granular cast means acute venous presence of eosinophil in urine may equals tubular interstitial nephritis. I know that it's not 100% perfect, but it give us ideas about the roadmap of diagnosis. So, and the presence of uric acid may denote gouty nephropathy. And this is a relatively newer schema based on evaluation of the urine by high bar field to detect the EBCL cell. So this is a renal tubular EBCL cell in urine. And this is a granular cast. If it is zero, it is score zero. If it is between 1 to 5, as you see here, 1 point. If both of them exceeding 5, this means this is a bad prognosis. So the more the tubular EBCL cell and the more the granular cast in the urine examination is another prognostic factor. One of the important stops and gates in the diagnosis is the discrimination of the patient regarding if the patient has a volume response of acute kidney injury or unresponsive acute kidney injury. This is a new name for pre-renal and intrinsic renal. So pre-renal means that the kidney tubules are healthy. So if the kidney tubules are healthy and exposed to hyperfusion, the normal consequence and the physiological defense is to preserve the sodium to phase dehydration, so urine sodium is low in perirenal or volume response of acute kidney injury. Also, the renal tubules are healthy, so it reabsorbs a lot of urea. So, urine creatinine is very important to diagnose perirenal, and these are the parameters of intrinsic renal. Again, I mentioned that BUN to creatinine ratio exceeding 20 is with the diagnosis of perirenal, but this is not a benign situation. Because as you see here, and I think there are many issues in medicine which is follows J-shaped curve or U-shaped curve. Here, if BUN creatinine exceeds 20, you are dealing with perirenal. If it is even higher, this is perirenal, but it's linked with increasing odds ratio of mortality. So we should correct the situation of hypovolemia, but what in our mind is the patient is risky for mortality. The use of biomarkers, this is a new era. It's not new, it's new in the current, in the last decades. And we have a lot of biomarkers, the conventional marker creatinine and urea, and are populated with protein like INGAR, neutrophil, gelatinase, associated like bucalin, kidney injury molecule 5.1, low molecular protein like this, and enzyme like this. So all these are pattern of biomarkers. This is a paper, came from the Cairo University, and as you see here, plasma INGAR was considered, or the result of the study showed that it is can be considered an early biomarker for the reduction of acute kidney injury and cardiac surgery. In Mansour, using cystatin C, serum cystatin C was proved in this study that it's more sensitive, specific, and accurate in comparison to creatinine. And the gold standard used in this study was isoclearance. But again, this is this issue of American Heart kidney disease. Don't find this a shocking study because it showed that serum cystatin C, it compares serum cystatin C versus creatinine based definition of acute kidney injury and default the patient. And the patient here, 1,150. So this is a relatively big, the size is adequate. And they showed that serum cystatin doesn't detect acute kidney injury earlier than creatinine, and creatinine is superior in sensitivity than cystatin C, and this is a shocking result. So we should, but the combination of high creatinine and high cystatin C carry a bad prognosis. One of the most important questions to be asked to us, when to do biopsy for patients with acute kidney injury,
If I am sure this is a perineal, there is no need for biopsy. If I am sure this is acute tubular necrosis, I leave time for recovery, so no need for biopsy. But if the cause is uncertain, if the urine analysis refer to presence of red cell counts or white cell counts or eosinophils, so I want to diagnose the glomerulonephritis and glomerulonephritis, I do biopsy. If the cause is uncertain or there is data referring to systemic disease, I do biopsy. If I give ample of time, 2 weeks to 1 month, and no recovery of tubular, I can do biopsy. So these are the indication of doing a biopsy. This normal kidney biopsy, and you can find here the tubules are back to back with delicate interstitial. This up to date the figure of Professor Helmut Reinke will establish acute tubular necrosis. The hole is lost and the debris are present in the lumen. So this is acute tubular necrosis. The most prone structures for acute kidney injury is the proximal S3 segment and the sick ascending limb of Henle, because these sites are very active sites. Again, just to demonstrate the value of biopsy, if the patient receives cocktail of antibiotics and non-steroidal, and you find the kidney is infiltrated by all these cells in interstitium, so this is a tubular interstitial nephritis. If the patient has sore throat and there is a weak lapse and the patient has nephritic syndrome, has nephritic syndrome, and you expose them to biopsy, you will find a lot of proliferation, neutrophil infiltration, and this is the IgG star sky appearance of post-infectious glomerulonephritis, and this is the classic sub-epithelial hump. Here the basement membrane, endothelial side, epithelial side, so this is sub-epithelial hump. And this is another patient with diabetic chemistry synodule. Here there is a tubular injury with a black stained structure inside the renal tubule, so this is acute phosphate nephropathy. And acute phosphate nephropathy is very critical, and I just presented this slide from a study published on the consequence of sodium phosphate enemas. Why I select this slide? Because we saw that the phosphate enemas acts locally by osmotic way, and no hazard of hyperphosphatemia and phosphate nephropathy. But what in this study showed, all patients, include 11 patients elderly, had acute renal failure. 2 patients had urgent hemodialysis. 5 deaths and prolonged hospitalization in 50% of survivor. And the conclusion was an elderly patient with an atonic bowel for whatever reason and a reduced GFR should not receive phosphate containing enema. Another new entity which was known in the pancreas, and if you find the biopsy, is this story form appearance. This is the inflammatory cell extends to the capsule of the kidney. This IgG4 related to infection nephritis, and the treatment is classical steroid. This is a very bad slide, very bad and gloomy slide. Why? Because this is a follow-up and the search for the outcome of acute kidney injury through 5 decades. This line reflects the number of patients in each study, and the column refers to the percentage of mortality. So in the 50s, the mortality was 42%, and currently it's 57%. So although there are major advancements in medicine, the mortality is still the same. So we should do something for the patient's survival. Many persons consider acute kidney injury as an isolated acute kidney disease, but it's actually not. And it is a systemic disease, and there is crosstalk between the kidney and other organs. So if you look here, the brain is affected, acute brain injury, lung injury, liver injury, bone marrow injury, and heart injury. And as you see, a lot of mediators, cytokine. So I think the area of development and involvement of regenerative medicine can do something. One of the studies, that abstract that was published in Paris last year in the European Society of in ERA Elite, is a crosstalk between the acute kidney injury and the brain. So this is Sally and Sarah, fifth year medical students, and they participated in activity. So they did ischemic review injury for the kidney, and I think Professor Sokol mentioned that in his presentation, and talk the brain, and I leave it to Professor Sokol. One of the important questions, does acute kidney injury lead to chronic kidney disease? If you read it in details, and you'll find debates, some authors say that a lot of, even 500,000 have a acute kidney injury and only a minority evolved a chronic kidney disease. So this is by chance. And this editorial professor stated that yes, acute kidney injury truly leads to CKD, and it seems that he is. There are many data is convincing that acute kidney injury may lead to CKD. One of the studies here, if the renal tubules are exposed to the diphtheria toxin, you can find consequently in the with comparison control a lot of fibrosis and sclerosis, and you can see here the sclerosis index. So primary disease affecting the tubule like this disease, like this experimental model, led to granulomatosis and fibrosis, which is CKD. And this is another important recent study showed that urinary kidney molecule, kidney injury molecule in urine, can predict the patient will develop CKD. So the KDIGO guidelines about this statement assist patients 2 months after acute kidney injury to evaluate the completeness of resolution and to detect new onset CKD or worsening of pre-existing CKD. Regarding the management, I go very fast in the management. So one of the most important critical conclusion regarding the fluid therapy is to start adequate fluid. If you have a patient with hypovolemia, treat him initially with adequate fluid. And when you satisfy the needs, then go conservatively. So if you compare this cocktail with other cocktails, if you start adequate and liberal, inadequate and conservative, inadequate and liberal, the best combination is to treat adequate in the beginning and complete the treatment with conservative treatments. And this is the best survival and lower mortality in comparison to others. If I want this is example of condition, I put 4-year-old construction worker who was in an accident, and after that creatinine increases. So the statement here, I want to answer this question rapidly. The best treatment is to, if this is a patient accident, if I give him saline, even at the accident site, and while we are transferring the patient to hospital, this would save him and rapidly treat the acute kidney injury, especially in rhabdomyolysis as in this case. One of the important questions, would I give the patient colloid or crystalloid? If you look at colloid, you can find it interesting, but the data are to the reverse. Here, this is study includes 7,000 patients, and it was randomized control trial, and found no difference between serum given albumin infusion or saline infusion. If there is even no difference between albumin and saline, why I give albumin, which is so expensive, to the patients without any benefit? So this is, even in the traumatic brain injury, you can find even saline is superior in the early mortality and the late mortality. So, and here is starch, and you can find that tubules are full of isometric vascularization. So this is starch nephrobacy or osmotic nephrobacy by starch. So colloids are not recommended. As you see here, in the absence of hemorrhagic shock, if there is hemorrhagic shock, I give blood. We recommend, if no hemorrhagic shock, this is a KDIGO guidelines recommendation, using isotonic crystalloid rather than colloids as initial management for expansion of intravascular volume. And as you see here, it is a recommendation level with moderate evidence, so it is our recommendation. Regarding diuretics, here recommendation against diuretics. The KDIGO guidelines recommend not using diuretics to prevent acute kidney injury. And I can use diuretics to just treat temporary hypervolemia, but I shouldn't continue giving diuretics and to delay the renal replacement therapy, because it will not affect, it will affect the outcome adversely. Even in septic shock, I can use vasopressors. It's severe to fluids. And just to sum up, I bought these statements, low-dose dopamine, it is a recommendation and the best evidence. No use for low-dose dopamine to prevent or to treat acute kidney injury. Also, don't use phenylethylamine to prevent or to treat acute kidney injury. Don't use ANB. For prevention, it's 1C, and for treatment, it's 1B. So also, we don't use. We don't use recombinant human insulin growth factor 1 or even estrobutin. And this is level 1B, so all these are negative. And here, aminoglycosides, the guidelines suggest not to use. We consider them unfriend and enemies for the kidney. And if you use them, please consider monitoring drug level. Regarding renal replacement therapy, I'll go through fast through renal replacement therapy because all modalities can be used according to the patient characteristic. But if the patient is hemodynamically unstable, I think CRRT is preferred But whatever the modality you have and you are acquainted with, use it. SLED, as Professor Elbaz presented here, and he will defend about the use of SLED. So if you can use intermittent dialysis or SLED and the patient hemodynamically is okay, it is the best for you and you are acquainted with the system, it's okay. But if the patient is hemodynamically unstable, the use of CRRT may be preferred. Don't use direct to postpone or to delay reinvestment therapy. When you use the in acute kidney injury situation, we used non-tunneled, non-cuffed casters. Because if we insist on tunneled caster, it takes time and it's expensive, and the patient may recover and need no tunneling. We use tunneling for end-stage kidney disease because tunneling increases the incidence of infection. When we decide to do cannulation, we start with right jugular vein, followed by the femoral vein, and then left jugular vein in this sequence, because we are afraid of subclavian venous stenosis. And if subclavian venous stenosis occur, this will decrease the likelihood of the good fistula later on if the patient doesn't recover. We suggest to use dialyzer with bicompatible membrane. Okay, this is okay. The dialysis dose, adequate dialysis dose will indicate it. PTV, PTORV, 3.9 per week, and this is a strong recommendation. One of the specific entity of acute kidney injury is intra-abdominal hypertension and abdominal compartmental syndrome, and these are the mechanisms because increasing abdominal pressure lead to decreasing the perfusion of the kidney, and the only way is to evacuate the collection in trauma or the intense ascites, and how to be sure of diagnosis by measuring the bladder pressure by manometry. If it is exceeding 25 millimeter mercury, it is intra-abdominal hypertension syndrome, and this is one of the correctors. Regarding contrast in this acute kidney injury, I think we have our own guidelines now, and it's published on the website, so we can use these guidelines because we reviewed everything is updated, and about this guidelines for the Egyptian Society of Nephrology that based on the discussion in June 2012. Regarding the use of stem cell therapies, you can review, you can refer to this form, and there are two sectors, mesenchymal stem cell, and the treatment acute kidney injury with allogenic mesenchymal stem cell, preclinical and clinical trials. And I think Professor Sopka will present this work because this is the work of two students, and I think the students present here regarding the use of mesenchymal stem cell to ameliorate septic acute kidney injury model. I think we are in a critical situation, either to change the map of acute kidney injury or we still with the high mortality. So I think we can diagnose acute kidney injury early. It may make a difference. And one of the parameters that was published this month about the post-operative proteinuria, so protein creatine ratio after cardiac surgery, even is superior to a pre-operative creatine protein in 1,100 patients in adults and 200 something in the children. And to conclude this presentation, we should put in our mind to risk for the patient because it's our job as physicians. Early detection and developing new therapies are warranted, and we should know the patient, the disease, which acute kidney injury, and route to treat drug therapeutics to change. If we don't have that data, so we are following the Voltaire statement, doctors are men or women who prescribe medicines of which they know little, for disease about which they understand even less, for people about whom they know nothing. And thank you for attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hussain, for a wonderful and in-depth coverage and a quick one too of AKI. I like very much that you touched the IgG4 related acute tumorous tissue nephritis, because this clinical entity is very interesting, and it has been described recently, the IgG4 related disease, and now we have a newcomer in nephrology as a disease, the acute tumorous tissue nephritis. Unfortunately, with all this wonderful knowledge you have said today, we know so much how acute renal failure happens and the cytoskeleton degradation and so forth and the biomarkers, yet the prognosis is still so bad. We have two forms, as I like to put it, the pure and the complex. Naturally, we are not treating any more pure forms of AKI, but rather the complex forms with the various morbidities. And no matter we know so much, yet still the prognosis is so bad. I think the future carries a lot. Pure stem cells maybe, and I'm eager to hear what Professor Sopp is going to say in this regard. Because all those drugs that we believed in a few years back, we are not using them, I know. But I still have hope science is moving and always something else is coming. Thank you very much, and maybe my colleagues would like to say something.
First,
طبعا احب احييك يا حسين,
انا دايما محاضراتك رائعه, وكل اساتذه المنصوره متميزين ومتمكنين من العلم, فدي حاجه شهاده مش مجامله. ممكن ترجع لي السلايد بتاع الباي ماركرز؟
حاضر.
الباي ماركرز اي ثينك وي شود نوت تيك ذم كولكتيفلي ان اول تايبس اوف اكيوت كيدني انجري, اند ذير شود بي سيلكتيف باي ماركرز ان ريليشن تو ذا تايب اوف انجري. يعني
اوكي
This
is a slide.
And time, yes.
This is
not talking about. يعني أقصد إن biomarkers should be selected according to the type of anticipated disorders. كان عندي ischemic injury, ولا عندي arthritis, ولا عندي toxic injury, and so on. And you should try to select which biomarker you are going to use in relation to the anticipated or expected injury. Could you elaborate شوية صغيرين على كده, وممكن تخليها later on عنوان محاضرة تانية, إن هو could select biomarkers in relation to selected kidney injury. بس لو تدينا highlight سريع ولا good, ما كانش ممكن تحضرها محاضرة
later. As you know, the biomarkers is magic tool. It was considered like this. And many authors working the biomarkers said a couple of years ago that it would solve all the complexities of acute kidney injury and many diseases. Yes, biomarkers are present in cardiology like troponin. In the kidney, they are pushing toward the benefit of any gel. But there are many data showing this side of the coin and the other side of the coin, to the extent that the editorial comment this month, right, that 1 year ago you are find that saying that biomarker will change everything, and to the extent that if the patient has normal creatinine or biomarker high and NGAL high, this acute kidney injury. If creatinine is high and NGAL is negative, this not acute kidney injury, this is another, like the use of antibiotics that raise creatinine falsely. But this month the editorials and a lot of publication, the end result saying that we should keep our gold friends, and we consider gold friends creatinine and urine, and we serve our new friends like biomarkers. So it seems that it works in publication well, but on the clinical ground there are many debates. And as I present the cystatin C after cardiac surgery, as you see, it was not sensitive and delayed in comparison to creatinine.
Can we classify them according to the can be glomerular markers, tubular markers, inflammatory markers of the AKI?
I know that it's rational and it is important classification, but if we go in details and in depth, because I reviewed a lot of publication in the biomarkers, we'll find they are not like you see.
How about proteomics? Has anybody been talking about proteomics?
I'm not much search proteomics, but I could get an injury عشان أرد على السؤال.
I don't know, that's why I'm asking.
لا هو يمكن أشار للبوينت ديت. حضرتك قلت دلوقتي في contribution للنانو ميديسن في different branches, وكان في proteomics as nano particles as biomarkers. ده topic مهم جدا دلوقتي في
المشكلة في الحاجات الجديدة دي.
بس الابليكيشنز بتاعتها زي ما حضرتك بتقول, يعني الابليكيشن بتاعها is very difficult and still in the future.
المشكلة حضرتك بدي يرجع لهذا الكلام, يعني ان قال حتى في ترانسبلانتيشن له علاقة بريجكشن, هو ايوه وصلي تاني على اكبر دول, لا بروتيومك شخص بريجكشن ايوه وعدد اكبر لا. فلازم لازم نتابع هذا الكلام بس اعمق وعدد اكبر, لان مش كل بيرمى على
الاساس. مظبوط.
بروفيسور
انا سعيد جدا بالمحاضره القيمه ويمكن عندي برضه انترست في الاكوتيك انجري. في حاجتين ويمكن دي واحده اللي انا بقصدها للاودينس وكل الناس اللي هي بيس تشيك لسيرم كرياتينين بري اوبريتيف لاي بيشنت. انا اسف الناس بياخدوا العيان ويعملوا عمليات وكلام من ده من غير ما يعرفوا وات از نورمال فور ذا بيشنت. بوست اوبريتيفلي بنشيك الكرياتينين. والحاجه الثانيه اليورين اوتبوت حتى في الانتنسيف كير ذلك في مراكز كبيره بره ان لازم دكتور النيفروزيست يمر الصبح وبالليل على العناية الريسبونسبيلتي بتاعه بيتشيك الحالات الجديدة شوف الكرياتينين خصوصا اللي بعد اكسيدنت او تروما او بتاع بوست اوبرتيف او يعني او كاردياك سيرجري والكلام ده شوف اليورين اوتبوت وشوف السيرم كرياتينين.
فلوس ولا بلاش؟
انا اتفق مع حضرتك تماما لان ده اللي مكتوب اللي هو المالتي سبيلر تيم ابروتش ان بتوين انتنسيف ليست والنيفروجست ميك ميك سايد.
الحاجه الثانيه برضو اللي احنا بنهتمش بيها اللي هو اليورين 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 واليورين كلر اليورين سبيسيفيك جرافيتي ده بيز اسمولايت هي هو سبيسيفيك جرافيتي سبيسيفيك جرافيتي لو ميز اكسلنت مع لو كونسنتريتد وهاي سبيسيفيك جرافيتي النوتس اللي بي مع العيال هيتصلح.
Thank you very much, Maradena. Now we move to the second lecture of this session. Hopefully it's going to be a very interesting lecture about the pathology perspectives of AKI, delivered by Professor Fatma Hosseini from Mansoura University. Pathology, طبعاً الحاجات اللي استريتنا جداً in medicine and nephrology in particular. I'm sure there is plenty to add for the nurses.
السلام عليكم. طبعا اكيد كيدني انجري كباثولوجي يعني ما اقدرش ان انا موضوع كبير جدا كباثولوجي فانا اخترت منه جاست حاجه الاكيد تيوبر نيكروزس على اساس ان احنا بنشتغل ريسيرش بادئين ريسيرش سيريز من الاكيد تيوبر نيكروزس اكسبيرمنتال انيمالز فهعرض الباثولوجي